surely good news to you that you are not alone. Hallelujah. And I'm not talking about aliens either. You know, we are not alone. No, we're not alone because God is with us. Amen. He's here. And He lives inside you. His whole purpose in creating us was so that He could have fellowship and relationship with us. For some reason, I don't necessarily know, I mean, everything about it, but for some reason, God saw fit to save me and you. He saw fit to say, I want to be restored what was otherwise tore up. I mean, he could have just walked away and said, they ain't worth it. But for some reason, He said He did. So therefore, don't let anybody ever tell you, you're not worth it. You are worth it. God saw, He didn't just see me, He didn't see just you or somebody else. He saw every person on the planet as worthy for Him to be able to come to the world and die for our sins so that we could have a relationship and be restored in a relationship with Him. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, last week we started a new series, and I called this God's Creative Power at Work. God's creative power at work. And it's not hard to see God's creative power at work if you just look around. Just look around, Jimmy. And I know sometimes people say, well, I see the world in a mess, and I see this and crime going on, and I see all kinds of things. But you're missing, you know, the fact that people make their own choices, and God lets people make choices. But let's first start with God's landscape. You know, I'm amazed sometimes people think that this planet just kind of came to be. There was just a big bang. Well, first of all, where did this stuff come from that caused a big bang? It just was here. And, you know, we just got back last night at we got into bed, I think it was about 4 o'clock this morning, and we just got back from Los Cabos, Mexico. Mexico. And, you know, Brian didn't even know it, but he's texting me yesterday, and I was in Los Cabos airport getting ready to come back from a few days of a little getaway, and as we looked around, we'd never been there, and we looked around the entire landscape, and it's just beautiful. It's just a beautiful place. The mountains and the ocean, and you might say, well, that's not my thing. Oceans are not my thing. Well, just look around. All you have to do is just look around the planet, and you'll see some beautiful landscape that God has created. Then go one step farther, which all that's fine. That's kind of like, you know, to us, that might be like pretty clothes. Somebody is a clothes designer. That's all right. That's important. But what is more important than the landscape, and what's more important than designing some pretty clothes? It's the people. And see, God created me and you. His creative power created me and you. And do you know how He created you? God created you by words. Even take Adam for example. When Adam was created, He shaped him out of the dust and the dirt of the ground. But then watch this. Before he came a man, what had to happen? God breathed the breath of life into him, and He said, man be. And so He created man. And so man was. And then He said, go replenish the earth. You know, and so what happened? People are men and women. Now, that ought to help us get some insight into this. But that men and women began to get together and recreate. And so it was based upon what God said. God said, go and do this. And so we have. And here we are today. So it all begins with God's word. And His word is what is creative. Now, we don't want to take the time to look there because we'd get lost in time. But last week, we looked in Genesis, and we saw the story of creation and how that everything God created, He said, let there be, let there be, let there be. And it was, and it was. Now, look this morning at Mark chapter 11, because I want to change just my thought just a little bit from God's creative power at work as the most powerful thing in the universe, and it is. But now I want to let's focus this and reel it in just a little bit to get focused on me and you. Because God created me and you in His image after His likeness. He told us that we would do the same things that He did, Jesus said, but greater. Not only that, but greater things. And so He's telling us that we have some ability within us. Now, we're not God, so don't construe that or misconstrue that to mean that that's what I'm saying. But we are sons of God. And with that comes certain privileges and authorities. And He tells us that some things that we can do. Let's look at this real quickly. Mark 11, chapter 11, verse 23. He says, "For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, and you shall have them." Now notice this. He says, "Whoever shall say unto this mountain." Now, God is telling us and showing us here that we have creative ability within our words. He's showing us that we create our world by our words. And He's showing us that we also can change things in our world by our words. Amen. Otherwise, why would He say that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, "Be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea"? Now, notice this. It doesn't come just by words, because if it was just that, people could just, you know, randomly just say things. And some do, and mistake that for faith. But He said, if you, whosoever shall say unto this mountain, "Be thou removed, be thou cast into the sea," and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe those things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. So in other words, He's saying that you can change some things. Now, you can't change other people in the sense that you go around saying, you know, I mean, I remember it was a number of years ago, Brother Hagin had made this comment, said people was, at one time, they was going around saying, "I confess that she will love me. I confess that he will love me," or something like, some crazy thing like that, because, you know, people thinking that they can just do anything. Well, you don't have no control, no power over somebody else. They just might not like you. They just might not think you're the most attractive person to them. Now, you're an attractive person to somebody. Right? I mean, they could be people look at me and go, I wouldn't want nothing to do with him. I think, you know, he did really well to get her. You know, you see what I'm saying? I mean, you don't have control over just because you want something in that sense over another person. But you can change your circumstances. You can change things around you based upon the way that you say it. God has told us that we can have what we can say. And so, the problem is, instead of us having what we say, we're saying what we have. Amen. That's good. We're not saying what we can have. We're just saying what we do have. And the problem is with that it's all based on, you know, things that our condition, our circumstance. And we live within our circumstances because that's what we've conditioned our mind to. We can't have any better, can't do any, and just can't change it. And we just have to live with whatever our lot in life is, whatever it is, it is. And we, you know, I mean, after all, I'm just blessed to be alive. Well, you are blessed to be alive, but you can be blessed even more than just being alive. You can be healthy and whole. You can be blessed and prosperous. You can have relationships restored. You can have things change in your life. But what about if you say that they won't change? Well, things never change. That always never works for me. What if you talk like that? You've already, the Bible says that it's out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaks. So we got to make sure that what we're getting on the inside of us is lining up to make sure that what's coming out is lined up with what we want. You know, I know it was, you've heard me tell this before, so it'll be like a broken record, but I'll tell it once again. I remember when Lauren was little, she went to the doctor and had told us that she had a heart murmur and some things, some physical things like that. And that's not necessarily a life-threatening thing, but it's nonetheless something you don't want to have to hear. Now, maybe you've heard worse. Maybe you've heard things, maybe you've heard some things physically that doesn't look like you're going to be able to prevail, or somebody that you know isn't going to be able to prevail. over something, and the first thought comes into your mind is, oh my gosh, this is over, this is it, I can't overcome this, I can't do this. Well, when we heard that, you know, it took me just a minute. Sometimes just be careful with your words, because your first response usually tells you where you're at in the abundance of your heart. So be careful with what you say. If you're about ready to unleash some words that are full of unbelief and doubt, you know what would be better to do is just not say anything. And let yourself just, you know, marinate, so to speak, on the situation, and make sure that you're getting your tongue in line with what should be inside your heart. And so, you know, we just had to kind of kick back a little bit, and I was driving down the road, and I was just praying, you know, and as I was praying, I was also saying. You know, it's hard to pray without saying. You know what I'm talking about? I mean, mentally, I know you can, you know, mentally connect, so to speak. But you know, there's something about words, or else it would have said, and God thought, light be, and light was. But notice this, he didn't say that. He said, God said. There's something about, he spoke. How many of you believe that on the day of creation, God was talking? Boom. He's talking and stuff is happening. And so when you're praying, you're saying. And so when I was praying, you know, I'm like, Lord, I don't believe for one minute that this is what your desire is. I stand against that right now. I don't believe that's from you. I don't accept that. I reject that. The Bible said that we can bind. We have the ability to bind and loose. And so I you know, I'm having this dialogue, and I'm like, I bind that work, that you know, that destructive thing that's trying to cause her a problem. I bind it. I'm responsible for her. You know, at least at that point. Now there comes a time that your kids are responsible for their own lives and their own actions. Now you can certainly pray for them and all like that. But you know, that's why it's important. The Bible says to train up a child in the way that they should go, because when they're old, what'll happen? They won't depart from it. And so it's important to teach your kids at an early age. And so that was what we was endeavoring to do. But at this point, I'm responsible for. So I'm standing against it, and I'm speaking the things that I want. I'm not saying what I don't want. I'm not sitting there going, Lord, I just know this is terrible, or this is awful. I can't believe this is happening. I she's going to have to be restricted. She's not going to be able to do certain things. I mean, I wouldn't let those words come out of my mouth. And so I'm saying things that are lined up with God's will, because the Bible said that he took our infirmities and he bore our sicknesses. So I'm making sure that the words that are coming out of my heart are lined up with what is his will. And his will, how many could you at least agree with me on this, that you believe that it's always the will of God for people to be in health? I mean, it don't take much. If you read the scriptures any at all, you'll find out that it's always God's will. He always wants to bless people. Now, him wanting to do it doesn't mean that it's automatic. Just the same way that it's always God's will for everybody to be healed. The Bible tells us God's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So if God's not willing anybody should perish, what's his will? His will is for everybody to repent and be saved, right? Well, how many of you believe that everybody repents and is saved? Of course not. But that doesn't mean it's not God's will. There's a difference. And so we have to acknowledge what we believe his will is. So I believe that it was the will of God for her to be healthy and whole. And so I just confessed those things. Just kept confessing them. And the Spirit of God spoke to me that day and told me some things and began to reveal to me about what was going to happen. And exactly, I came back and told Debbie, and it happened exactly the same way that the Lord had spoke to me that day. Well, what happens if you're just talking negative all the time, and you're just, you know, you don't have anything good to say, and you just I'd never get a good break. It never works for me. Why'd I always have a problem? Well, it's because you talk like that all the time is why you always got a problem. Sure. How about you get your mouth lined up with what should be inside of your heart, because again, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks, and we begin to find out what it is that the will of God is for us. It will work for you. The creative power that God used to be able to create the world, create me and you, that same creative ability is inside of you in your words. The creative ability from God is available to you, but also destructive creative ability is available to you too. Because you can cause either blessing to come or you can cause cursing to come. That's why he says, out of your mouth, there's blessing and cursing. This shouldn't be. So he's showing us that our mouth is just super important with how that we perceive our world and what happens in our world, the realities that come into our lives. That's the same way you got saved. If you're saved, you didn't get saved without doing two things, believing and speaking. You had to be able to say that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. It's two things. It's always believing and speaking. It's always what's in the heart coming out of the mouth that causes things to happen for your good or for your destruction. If what's in your heart is that, well, I never get a break. God doesn't love me. He doesn't care about me. This, I just can't seem to ever make anything work. It always fails. Anything I touch turns to, you know what? Use your imagination. Well, if that's what you're saying, that's what's coming out of your heart. But what if you could change the way that you perceive what God wants for you? What if you could change the way that you speak based upon what's inside of your heart and coming out of you out of the abundance of your heart? Now you're speaking the blessings of God over your life. I'm telling you, you should be watching every word that comes out of your mouth to make sure that it is lined up with what God wants for us. Hebrews 4, verse 14 says, seeing then that we have a great high priest that has passed into the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Now notice this. He starts this off saying, seeing then, or because of this, because we have a great high priest that has passed in the heavens, and he recognizes who that is, Jesus, the Son of God. Because of that, let us hold fast our profession, which is just another word for confession. Let us hold fast. Let us hold tight to our confession because we have a high priest. That's who's given us the right and the ability to be able to make the confessions that are connected with God, because Jesus is our high priest. And so before we ever make a confession, we should ask ourselves, who said it and what's its source? Ask yourself before you get ready to say something, well, where'd that come from? What's the source of that thought? And if you'll play the thought out in your mind, you'll find many times that the thought that you were about ready to unleash into words were not from the source of God. And what do you think, if you're saying something that is full of doubt and unbelief, where do you think the source would come from? God, listen, God just doesn't have faith. He is faith. Everything about God is faith. There's no such thing as doubt and unbelief in God. God doesn't, you know, one day, you know, I know how you are sometimes, and the reason I know how you are is because that's the way I am sometimes. I struggle with something, I go, and I find myself, you know, easing into an unbelief or easing into doubting a situation, and I have to check myself just the same way you have to check yourself and say, whoa, wait just a minute. No, I believe God. I believe God. Well, that don't happen to God. There's no indecision, and some days he's having a good day, some days he's having a bad day. God has a good day every day. He's full of belief every day. He's full of faith every day. And he wants me and you to be full of faith every day. Well, if it doesn't agree with God's word, then what would you say? I told you last week, there people act like there's some kind of middle ground here. I know this is tough, but some folks think that, well, I'm kind of right here, I'm straddling right in the middle. Not really in unbelief, and I'm not necessarily really in faith, but I'm somewhere in between. If you're not in faith, then you're in unbelief. It's just that simple. And if you're not in unbelief, then you're in faith. You're either one of the two. And so if it didn't come from God, where did it come from? Now notice this in Matthew chapter 16, verse 19, very interesting verse here. He says, and I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom. Now, he didn't say I'll give unto you the keys in the kingdom. Because if he has given you the keys in the kingdom, that means you're inside. He says, I'm giving you the keys of the kingdom, which means now you have an ability to use them. keys of the kingdom. And whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven. So he's saying, I want you, I'm giving you something that's from heaven. In other words, he's saying, I'm giving you the ability to be able to bind and loose. Well, how do you bind and loose? Is he talking about coming up to Marco and putting some rope on his hands and binding him? I bind you. No, he's not talking about that physically. He's talking about binding and loosing with your mouth. He's talking about using your mouth to bind things that are otherwise. Do you know sometimes you have to bind your own words because you say something and you catch yourself and you go, oh. Shouldn't have said that. I bind those words in the name of Jesus. Those were wrong. Now, maybe that's just me. Maybe you never have to do that. Maybe you're kind of on target all the time. But for me, every now and then, I got to go, oh, I got to stop those words. Now, look at this. In Matthew chapter 12, he says that a good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure brings forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. Every idle word. Now that word idle simply means non-effective or non-working. I suspect some of you got a lot to account for. I don't know who, so don't get mad at me because I ain't pointing no fingers. I suspect all of us have some measure of this to deal with. Every idle word, non-effective word, we go through life. Now, that doesn't mean you can't enjoy life and have some fun and mess around. Don't misunderstand me. Don't get super spiritual on me here. He's talking about here that we just say anything. We let words out. Words are creative power. Words create things, negative or positive. And he says here that every idle word, what men speak, shall they give account of in the day of judgment. For by their words shall they be justified, and by their words shall they be condemned. Justified or condemned. Now, condemned is not necessarily mean condemned to hell. It's not necessarily what he's talking about. It could be that. But it also could be condemned to fail. Your words can cause success or they can cause failure. And so when we just begin to just all the time speak negative things, this isn't going to work. I don't know how we can get through this. This will be the death of us. You know, we should watch what we say. And I know sometimes you don't mean it, you know, but it's words. Oh, that tickled me to death. How in the world did that phrase ever kind of become a common phrase? Oh, it just tickled me to death. Think about it. Is that really something that you want to say? We have to watch what we're saying. We have to judge the words that come out of our mouth, because he's telling us that we're going to be justified or we're going to be condemned by the things that we say. That's why that when we don't have enough and we're struggling with things, we're struggling with our financial situations, what should be some of the things that we're saying? Should we say, I can't ever get enough. Why can't I make ends meet? How is it that I can do these things? I just can't make anything work. I never get a break. Why do all these things happen to me? Well, number one, first question I'd ask you is, are you a giver? Amen. Now I started to begin to meddle. Everybody's thinking you was doing all right until you get into that. You start meddling with my money. Well, are you a giver? That'd be the first thing to ask. But then secondly, I'd also say, what are you confessing? Are you confessing Philippians 4:19 that my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus? Or are you confessing, I don't know where I'm going to get my next, you know, paycheck from. I don't know where I'm going to get my next meal. I don't know how things are going to work out. I never get a break. Seems like everybody else gets a break. He gets a break. She gets a break. I just can't have anything good happen to me. I'm telling you now, something that'll frustrate me more than anything, quicker than anything, is when a bunch of negative talk gets around me. Because listen, you hang around negativity long enough, you know what it'll do? It will rub off on you. You have to either deal with that, or they're going to deal with you. And so I don't want negativity. I don't like that, because first of all, not just a concept, because it's ungodly. It's an ungodly thought. And when we're having people say, well, nothing good ever happens to me. Well, that's not what the Bible said. The Bible says you're blessed. Amen. And so, you know, when you get somebody that's talking like that, they'll pull you down. Did you ever notice that? I mean, people, the old phrase, misery loves company. Miserable people love to get other people miserable with them. They like company. They want somebody else to feel bad with them. Well, I got a bad break. You should feel bad for me. Where do you think those thoughts come from? Is God saying, well, he's miserable, let me at least give him some company? I don't think so. Those aren't coming from God. What do you say when sickness is attacking your body? Do you just embrace it and say, well, I'm just suffering for Jesus? Why would you suffer for Jesus? Where's the scripture that says that you should physically suffer for Jesus? Yes, you will go through some persecution sometimes. You will have people that will persecute you because of what you believe, but not your body. Where's that scripture at? You'll not find that scripture. It says, oh, I'm just suffering for Jesus. No, you got to get it settled inside of you that the Word of God says that He wants you healthy and whole. He wants you restored. It doesn't mean you won't get under attack. Some of the best people on the planet, as far as faith-filled people, still get attacked. The difference is many of those overcome because of what they believe and because of what they say. They're creating their world. They're changing their world based upon the words that are coming out of their mouth rather than, something negative or something that's in unbelief that's coming out of their mouth. Words will either work for or against you. What do you want them to do? You want them to work for you? Then your words have to line up with what the scriptures say about you. That's why when people are coming in, they say, they come to church and they go, well, I'm not worthy. That church, if the lightning would strike me if I come in that bit. Oh, you've heard them all. Oh, I tell you what, now I've gone too far, done too much. Who says? Show me a place in the Bible that God says, you've done too much, you've gone too far. How many people did Jesus die for? Did he die for every person on the planet? How many people was the stripes, according to 1 Peter 2:24, how many people was Jesus whipped for so that they could be healed? Every person on the planet God had in mind. Now, that doesn't mean every person will take advantage of it, but you either let the words work for you or they work against you. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 20 says, my son, attend to my words, incline your ears unto whose sayings? My sayings, his sayings, God's sayings. Let them not depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart. Well, what happens out of the abundance of the heart? So what happens if the word of God is in the midst of your heart? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. For they are life unto those that find them, health to all their flesh. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are all the issues of life. Keep your heart. In other words, don't let stuff get in that you know is opposed to what God wants. Reject it. Don't embrace those. That's why the Bible talks in 2 Corinthians about casting out every imagination, every thought that doesn't line up with what God's Word says. Cast it out. Don't embrace it. It's so easy to get coddled into, believing lies because you feel bad, or just because physically your body isn't doing what you otherwise want it to. Financially, you're not where you want, so you begin to feel sorry for yourself. This is one of the main things the devil wants to do to you. He wants you to feel sorry for yourself. Oh, I tell you what, I never get a break. I've been sick for years now. I see other people get it, but I guess it isn't for me. That's exactly what he wants you to do. Feel sorry for yourself, because when you begin to feel sorry for yourself, there's no place to look for help. You're embracing other people, and you want other people to come in and say, oh, you're right. You, I tell you what, you don't get any breaks. Keep them people away from me. If I was to say some of those things, I want somebody, you know, to jerk the slack out of me. I want somebody to say, did you hear what you're saying? Shut that up. Get your mouth in line. Where you have to make yourself think, go, okay, I shouldn't have said that. That's why the Bible tells us that Proverbs chapter 6, verse 2, that we are snared. We're trapped by the words of our mouth. We put ourselves in jail based upon what we say. And if we say the wrong things, what would we think that we would get? Ask yourself this. How's it working out for you? Now, don't answer that, because then you're going to be telling, I didn't ask for volunteers. How's it working out? We are a product of our prior words that we've been saying over our lives. What do you say over your kids? What do you say over your spouses? Do you say, my kid is an idiot, my kid is a dummy, you moron? Now, you understand your kids are going to make mistakes. Let me just help you with this one. Your kids are going to make mistakes, but that mistake does not have to define them and should not define them. Mistakes are mistakes. They're going to happen. The Bible says that all of sin comes short of the glory of God, and that includes your kids and you. Hello. Your kids have come short of the glory of God. They failed. That does not make them an idiot. They maybe did an idiotic thing, but you probably haven't ever done an idiotic thing before. Don't turn them into that based upon what they say. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let them say it. You should be saying stuff over your life. I know it sounds crazy and sounds weird, but you ought to be saying things over your life. You ought to be saying, I'm a blessed man, even when you don't feel like a blessed man. You ought to be saying, I'm a well man, even when you don't feel like you're a well man. People say, well, you're lying. No, I'm just confessing the word of God over my life. I'm a blessed man. I'm a well man. I'm a healthy man. I'm a healed man. Well, and if you're a woman, just make sure you get that part right. I'm a blessed woman. I'm a healed woman. Today you just have to just be sure. Proverbs 13 says, a man shall eat good by the fruit of his mouth. By the fruit of your mouth, you eat good things. Proverbs 18, verse 21 says, death and life are in the power of the tongue. We know all these, but the question is, are you doing these things? Let me say this, deliverance is always as close as your mouth. Miracles are always as close as your mouth. That's how close that you are to a miracle, is just by releasing words of faith and getting your heart lined up with what it is that you said. You know, it's very faith enriching when you hear yourself speak faith-filled words. Yes. Even if you're not to the place that you believe them, when you hear yourself speaking those words in an effort, in an attempt to get yourself into a place of faith, when you hear you speak faith-filled words, it'll do something for you that wouldn't necessarily happen just by somebody else saying them and you hearing them. Because it puts you in the equation. When you say, I will overcome this. I will. Not I might. You can't say those kind of things. Now, real quick, turn over to Daniel chapter 3. Daniel chapter 3. While you're turning there, let me just tell you this. You set your words, or you set the works in motion by the words that come out of your mouth. What you say puts things into motion. Words are like containers. Be like if you had this pot thing here, you put fill that up with a bunch of stuff in it. It's a container. It holds them. Your words are like holding all these things that you say. And see, what you're doing is you're creating an atmosphere around you based upon how you perceive things. That's why it's very important. Even the songs that we sing. You know, I don't believe in just singing a song. You got to analyze the song. What's being said? Is it faith-filled words? Is it God, you know, inspired words? Is it scriptural? You say, you mean your songs have to be scriptural? Duh. That's a confession. Songs are confessions with a tune. And that's why it's so important that when we're in a time of worship, what you're doing is you're making confessions. You begin to say whatever it is the song is saying, and you're saying, if you're singing along, what's coming out of your mouth? Words. You're saying things that are going into the atmosphere, and you're hearing yourself say them. That's why we're always encouraging, get involved. Don't just be a participant and stand there and just watch. Be a participator, not a spectator. Daniel chapter 3. Now you know the story. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego have been on the verge of meeting their fate. They've refused to bow. They refuse to yield. And the king is giving them one last opportunity. He tells them, if you'll do this, then everything will be well. We'll forget. We'll just let it go. That you refuse to do it at first, it'll all be okay. But if not, just know this, that I'm going to put you in the furnace, and then we're going to turn it up 7 times hotter than it's ever been, and you're going to die. Who is that God that'll deliver you out of my hands, the king is saying. Now watch this. This is their response. They said, we are not careful to answer you in this matter. He says, if it be so, and I have something to say about that in just a minute. If it be so, our God whom we serve is able. That's one thing to be able. It's awesome to serve a God that's able, isn't it? But you also have to know that he's willing. See, you can know that he's able. I know you're able to heal me, Lord. Oh, I just wish you would. Well, you just ruined that one. I know that he's able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace. And if we've caught him on a good day, he will. Is that what it said? We know he's able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us out of your hand, O king. Now notice this, and this is where people really blow it. But if not, be it known unto thee, O king, that we will not serve thy gods nor worship the golden image which thou hast set up. This is one of the most misunderstood scriptures. I don't know how many different times I've heard people talk about this. Now, they were so committed that they believed God. Ha! But if they didn't, ha! But if God didn't do it, ha! They still wouldn't yield. That is not what he is saying. You have to read. That's why you can't just read a little something here and a little something there. You read the whole thing in context of what he's trying to say. What he was saying was this: if God even lets you put us in, if you put us in, know this, O king, we will not serve your gods, and God, the God whom we serve, is able, and he will deliver us if you put us in. And if you don't put us in, let it be known to thee, O king, that we will not bow down. Because after all, if you put us in and he don't deliver us, there's no problem with us not bowing down, because we'll be ashes. You don't have to worry about bowing down when you don't have a structure of a body, right? If you put us in, the God whom we serve is able to deliver us from your hand, O King, and he will. And if not, if you don't put us in, I can tell you right now, we definitely are not going to bow down. So you make the choice. You put us in, he'll deliver us. You don't put us in, we won't bow down. Now notice this. Did they come to this place in a mental assent? Did they come in like thinking those thoughts and just staying right there? What did they have to do? They had to transform a thought to a word. The God whom we serve is able to deliver us from your hand, O King, and he will deliver us. He will. There's no stronger assertion when he says he will or he shall. In other words, it leaves no room for any doubt whatsoever. In other words, they've come to the conclusion, I put all my trust in God. I've totally submitted and yielded to him. He will. I know he will. What about you? Are you creating your world by your words the way that God wants your world to be? He is a magnificent artist. The world was his canvas. He spoke the world into existence. He spoke you into existence. He's created and crafted things. And he's telling us that we are to do the same thing. The same things and greater things shall you do because they're going to my Father. He's saying, just use your words. Change the things that you've been doing and the place that you've had in life. If you don't like where you're at, change it. Now, I want you to notice one more place. Turn over to Revelation chapter 12. I'll try to get ready to close here. Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. Now look at this. He said, and they overcame him. They're talking about you'd have to read the whole context. And we just don't have the time to get into all that. But if you take the time to get into it, read the context of what Revelation chapter 12 is talking about. They overcame the enemy, the devil, the dragon. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. Now that was God's action. There was two things that we really had to have in order to be saved. God, before Jesus came to the world, we had to have God take some action to undo some things. Jesus became the second Adam. Whatever Adam messed up, Jesus restored back. So that was the first thing. God had to take action. So he says, and they overcame him, the enemy, by the blood of the Lamb. In other words, the Lamb of God, which is Jesus Christ, hit just like a lamb was presented as a sacrifice each year. At times of sacrifice, they would slit its throat and drain the blood, and the blood would be presented as the sacrifice for the atonement of the sins of the people. So Jesus is the Lamb of God, is the atonement for the sins of all people, all time, forever. In other words, never have to do it again. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, God's action, and by the word of their testimony. How do you share a testimony without a word? It'd be like me saying, I'd like to share my testimony with you. And you go, great. Wasn't it good? And they'd go, what do you mean? I gave you my testimony. Well, I didn't hear anything. Oh, I just thought it. I thought my testimony, I thought you'd pick it up. No, they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb. That's the first thing that you have to recognize if you want to overcome the situation and the problems, circumstances of your life. You want to overcome all that first? You got to first recognize that the first thing is put your confidence in the blood of the Lamb. That's the first thing, which is obviously Jesus, knowing that he took your sin. Then the second thing is that you have to overcome him by the word of your testimony, which means you have to begin to speak, I'm an overcomer. Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. No weapon formed against me will prosper. You've got to begin to say the things that God calls you. I'm an overcomer. I'm blessed. I'm blessed by the words of my mouth. And you begin to say those things. You begin to say, I'm a blessed man. He took my infirmities so that I wouldn't have to be sick anymore. He became poor that I might be made rich. You begin to say the things that you know that he wants for you. You say Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. You know, when he's talking about that my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. He's got me covered. How you speak will craft your world to be what God wants for your world to be. Not just what you, if you can imagine the best life that you can imagine for yourself, to have more than enough, to be a blessing to others, to be in a position to give, to see your kids walking with God and saved, and you, the people that you love, to see all of them blessed and walking with God, all of that. You want all those things? If you want those things, how much more does God want those things? God wants that personified for you. You don't even realize how much God wants you blessed. You don't even realize how much God wants you healed. You don't even realize how much God wants you, you know, your family restored and relationships restored. God wants all of these things. So what are you going to do to get it? Well, I believe it when I see it. Well, you won't see it, because you only believe it when you see it. And the Bible says you got to believe it before you see it. Whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, be thou cast in the sea, and shall doubt in his heart, shall believe those things which he saith, he shall have whatsoever he saith. It comes after you say and after you believe, not before. You change your world by your words. You change your world by your beliefs. Get those two connected, and you'll watch that the hand of God will begin to craft your world, begin to change the things all around you that need to be changed. Are you open to that? Are you open to God changing? If you are, then you got to begin to say the things that God wants you to say. Watch what comes out of your mouth. Know that your words are creative, because they rest inside your head. And they convince you. And when you say things that are contrary to the Word of God, then what you're doing is you're lining your words up with the enemy. You know, in Daniel there, they confessed victory in the face of apparent defeat. Right in the midst of apparent defeat, they confessed that they was victorious. You don't have to be able to see it. You just have to be able to trust. I don't need to know how the watch is made. All I have to know is how to tell time. All I need to do is know how to read some scripture and say, well, wait just a minute. I don't know how God's going to do it, but he said he'd do it. He loves me. He's crazy about me. He'll bless me. He'll find a way to get it to me if I'll just trust him. So I believe him. I trust him. I believe he'll find a way. If you'll do that, what do you think will begin to happen? Don't ever say what you don't want. Don't do that. Watch your words. If you'll begin to judge what you say, you know, don't ever say, I've gone too far. I've done too much. I can't change. This is who I am. I just can't help it. No, you can help it. You can change your world by your words, by the atmosphere that you put yourself in. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. I think so many times we forget what God has done for us and what he wants for us. And as I was coming to church this morning and I was just meditating, kind of getting my heart and my head wrapped around what I wanted to say today, I was just listening to some music in the background here, and there was a song that came on. And before I pray for you, I want you to hear the song. I want you just to embrace this just a minute. I want you to realize that this is the way that God thinks about you. And if you don't think about you this way, if you don't see yourself this way, if you don't talk about yourself this way, then you won't get it. But I believe that you are. I believe you're getting it this morning. So I want to go ahead and play that and just listen to the words of this song.
second chance. Your grace and endless river. Your love an avalanche. There in my darkest moment, all hope burned to the ground. That's where your mercy found me. That's when your love came down. You turned my mourning into dancing. You turned my sorrow into praise. Yeah, you give me beautiful ashes, beautiful ashes. You give me beautiful ashes, beautiful ashes. Love spoke a new tomorrow. Open my eyes to see. Love washed away this sadness. Love came and rescued me. You turned my mourning into dancing. Oh yes you did. You turned my sorrow.
Now, I didn't just come up with those words, and he didn't just come up with those words just randomly. Do you know that's in the Bible? That God gave you beauty for ashes. And that's the way that we should see ourselves, and that's the way we should talk about ourselves. He's paid the ultimate price so that we could have that kind of relationship with him. So if you would right now, just bow your heads. I want to ask you the most important question that anybody could ever ask you. Is where your relationship is with God, because He's already done all the work. He's already paid the ultimate price. He's not going to do any more than He's already done. It's been paid, paid in full. So the question is, will you accept that? Will you accept the price that has been paid? Will you confess over your life that God loves you more than anything that you could possibly... There's nothing that means any more to Him beyond you. He tells us in His Word that if we would confess with our mouth and believe in our heart that God has raised Him from the dead, that we'd be saved. For with the heart, we believe unto righteousness, and with our mouth, confession is made unto salvation. It means if we'll believe and we'll confess, it brings us to a place of relationship with Him. Oh, there's nothing, anything that's any more important. You can take every trip. We just took a trip. It was great. But there's nothing. There's nothing that'll fulfill you. There's nothing that's going to bring you to a place of fulfillment besides Him. I don't care what you get to do. I don't care what you get to own or possess. I don't care how much money you have. It doesn't matter. You could do anything that you want to do. There's no restrictions. None of that. None of that would come close to bringing fulfillment to you. There's only one thing that's going to fulfill you, and that's a relationship with Him, with every head bowed, every eye closed. If that's where you are right now, maybe you don't know the Lord Jesus, but something's been said, and you say, wait just a minute, I've been saying the wrong things over my life, and I know that He does love me. He wants me and His family. He wants to bring me to a place of relationship. If that's you right now, every head bowed, every eye closed, would you raise your hand and say, Pastor Phil, that's me. I'm not where I need to be with God, but I know that I can get there. It's as simple as believing in my heart and confessing with my mouth.